Hi, this is Corey Franklin with Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who died recently who've had a profound effect on our history or our society or our culture. And tonight we're going to start out with Lynn Buck Compton, who died at the age of 90. And Buck Compton actually had a profound effect on our history two times. The first time was in World War II. Buck Compton was a member of E Company, the Easy Company, the Band of Brothers. And as you know, last year we did Dick Francis, who was one of the leaders of Band of Brothers. It was the subject of the HBO miniseries. It was the story of a number of American soldiers who landed behind the German lines in France and made the march through France into Germany at the end of World War II. Very heroic miniseries. Buck Compton was one of those soldiers, and he won a Purple Heart. Here is Neal McDonough, who played Buck Compton in the Band of Brothers HBO special, talking about what it was like to play him and what he did. And as you'll notice, and as I've said before, most of our military heroes were very modest people.
He's just a larger-than-life guy who was the most humble cat who achieved so much. He reminded me of my father. Right. And, my father was, straight off the boat from Ireland. And so when I met Buck, he reminded me so much of my dad that immediately I was like, oh, I'm going to really enjoy our friendship. He knew that, since I'm playing him, he had to open up a little bit. When People Magazine, we did a spread on Buck up at his house in Seattle. His daughters were there, and he'd lived in this house for a very long time. The People Magazine people said, can we see your Purple Heart and your Silver Star? And the girls are like, where is that, Dad? We don't even know where that is. And he went upstairs to his attic and pulled out the shoebox, and there it was, blew off the dust, and there was his Purple Heart and a Silver Star. And his daughters were like, why have you never shown us these things? And he goes, well, I just never wanted you to know what it was like. It took a while for Buck to open up to me, to start telling me things. And, when I was over in London, jeepers, I would pepper him with questions every week. Say, okay, so your Thompson, where did you keep your Thompson? Did you keep it on your left or your right? What kind of magazines did you do? Where'd you have your magazines? Did you ever smoke? Did you drink? Did you do this? Do that? You say, how was the landing? Oh, I blew out my leg when I landed. Okay. Well, he blew out his leg, but yet he still marched through this whole thing, and he lost all of his stuff, and, landed into a tree, and, didn't have anything. Didn't have any food, didn't have a gun, didn't have anything, and he had to, pry it off a German soldier.
McDonough was so impressed with Buck Compton that he actually named his son Buck after Buck Compton. As I said, Easy Company was one of the groups of soldiers who helped the United States march through France and Germany to capture Berlin at the end of the war. And interestingly enough, Buck Compton didn't really get that much credit until the Band of Brothers movie series. And the other interesting thing is he was a two-sport star at UCLA. He was on the same teams as Jackie Robinson. But he really didn't get much public notice until he left the military, went into law, and then in June of 1968, his life was changed again, and he had a little part in changing American history once again. The setting for the next part of the story is it's June 4th, 1968, in Los Angeles. Hubert Humphrey is the vice president. He looks like he'll be the nominal head of the party and the candidate in the 1968 election since Lyndon Johnson is stepping down, but he's faced a challenge from Robert Kennedy and Gene McCarthy. Humphrey is not on the ballot in the California primary that night, but Kennedy and McCarthy are, and the winner has a good chance of challenging Hubert Humphrey at the Democratic Convention in Chicago in August. Kennedy wins a very, very close primary, and here is his victory speech at the Ambassador Hotel on the night of June 4th, 1968.
So I thank all of you. Those of you are here. Mayor Yorty has just sent me a message that we've been here too long already. So my thanks to all of you, and now it's on to Chicago, and let's win there. Thank you.
Less than 5 minutes later, before he gets a chance to even leave the hotel in a kitchen pantry, Robert Kennedy is shot in the head by Sirhan Sirhan. And you can still hear some of Kennedy's supporters cheering before the news breaks out that he's been shot.
He still has the gun. The gun is pointed at me right at this moment. I hope they can get the gun out of his hand. Be very careful. Get the gun. Get the gun. Get the gun. Stay away from the gun. Stay away from the gun. His hand is frozen. Get his thumb. Take a hold of his thumb and break it if you have to. Get his thumb.
Hold him. We don't want another Oswald.
The assassination of Robert F. Kennedy, and Lynn Compton was the district attorney who prosecuted Sirhan Sirhan for the murder of Robert F. Kennedy. And here is Lynn Compton's biographer, Marcus Brotherton, explaining Lynn Compton's role in the prosecution of Sirhan Sirhan.
I've developed a very airtight case that proved, I believe without a shadow of doubt, that Sirhan was guilty. They investigated the crime itself, and they marshaled the evidence against Sirhan, and then they really needed to determine his mental state at the time. And, you know, the mental state of a slayer is really critical in any homicide prosecution. In order for them to prove that a first-degree murder had taken place, they required proof that Sirhan actually was the one who did the shooting. He did so knowingly and intentionally, and that he actually premeditated the crime. So if he had any help from other people, you know, Buck was very prepared to prove who they were and what their motive was. And, you know, it just wasn't the case.
Speaking of that 2008 biography of Lynn Compton, here is Marcus Brotherton talking about it.
The irony was, when we started writing the book, he had a bit of the manuscript written already, probably about a third of it. And he had written absolutely nothing about the war, not one word. And his reason was twofold. He... In his words, he thought it had all been covered before. And then he believed that readers would be more interested in his life as a judge later on. But really, when he was pushed on this, it was due to a real reluctance to go there. He just didn't want to talk through these stories of horror.
I want to thank BBC4 for those interview clips. But the final word on Lynn Compton comes from Lynn Compton himself. Near the end of his life, he talked about his war experiences. And again, characteristic of so many heroes was his modesty.
There's one thing I would like to say, though I think this is as good a time as any for me to say it, is that you'll notice that we were in the Normandy, we were out and back in England, we went into Holland, eventually we're out and back to France, more than one with Graham, now we're in Zulu, Bastogne. The point being that we were in and out. And I always like to tell people that we really feel that we had it easier. And I think I would not have traded places with any of the guys that were in the line divisions, like the one and the four, you know, that slogged their way across Europe or across the South Pacific on a day-to-day basis. I wouldn't trade places with any of them. So I don't want anybody to ever get the idea that because we've gotten this sort of publicity or whatever you want to call it out of this Band of Brothers thing, that we think that we're a cut above anybody else. In fact, I don't think we did as much as a lot of other guys did in this war. What we are really are representatives of a microcosm of young guys in their 20s that were brought together from all walks of life and not professional soldiers, put together and made into a good fighting unit. That was the thrust of Band of Brothers. It was not, there's a certain mystique about jumping out of airplanes or anything, but it's not, that was not the thrust of Band of Brothers. A character study, but it's also a study of what can be done by a nation of people who have a certain amount of freedom, independence, and ingenuity.
The four was my father's company. Thank you for mentioning him, and thank you, Lynn Compton. I'm going to move on quickly now to a completely different world, the world of disco, and Jimmy Ellis, who died at the age of 74. Brief mention of Jimmy Ellis, who was the lead singer of the Trammps. In the 1970s, disco became a big thing in the United States, and it was largely based on one movie, Saturday Night Fever with John Travolta. One of the big songs from Saturday Night Fever was a song called Disco Inferno. The lead singer was Jimmy Ellis. The song did reach the top 10. Disco quickly burned out after about 5 years, but Jimmy Ellis will always be remembered for this. burn that mother down. We're going to move away from disco and close tonight with Robert Sherman, the older half of the Sherman brothers. Richard was his younger brother. Robert died at the age of 86, and he and his brother were the songwriters for Walt Disney. And here they are with Walt at the 1964 World's Fair General Electric Pavilion.
So there's a great big beautiful tomorrow, shining at the end of every day. There's a great big beautiful tomorrow, just a dream away.
Well, it sounds pretty good. In fact, that's just the right spirit. Our songwriters, Dick and Bob Sherman of the Walt Disney Studio. The Sherman brothers have written many of the wonderful songs for motion pictures and television shows.
The story of how Bob Sherman got associated with Walt Disney is a fascinating one. He was a nice Jewish boy born in New York City. His family moved out to Los Angeles. His father was a songwriter who wrote two great songs. The first is a Depression-era classic. I was debating whether to play the 1960s Tiny Tim version or the 1930 Maurice Chevalier version. I went with the Chevalier version. Again, 1930 Chevalier and coffee only costs a dime.
I'm so happy, happy-go-lucky me. I just go my way, living every day. Haven't got a lot, I don't need a lot. Coffee's only a dime. Living in the sunlight, loving in the moonlight, having a marvelous time.
Great song. The other song that Al Sherman, Robert's father, wrote is another 1930s classic.
You gotta be a football hero to get along with a beautiful girl. You gotta be a touchdown getter, you bet. If you wanna get a baby to pet, the fact that you are rich or handsome won't get you anything in curls. You gotta be a football hero to get along with the beautiful girl.
Two songs by Robert Sherman's father, Al. Robert went off to war, and he became one of the first American soldiers to liberate Dachau. He was injured during the war. He won a Purple Heart, and he spent his recuperation in England, where he was influenced by English culture. So he was a war hero, and that doesn't get mentioned much in his story. He came back, knocked around for a while, and was associated with the Disney Studios when he wrote for their superstar of the 1950s, the most famous Mouseketeer, she of the precocious talents, Annette Funicello, in one of her pop ditties. You have to imagine Annette singing this in her sweater, by the way. No further comment on that one. At that point, Robert and his brother Richard went to work full-time for the Disney Studios, and I'm going to let Brian Sibley of BBC4, who knew them, tell the story.
It's supercalifragilisticexpialidocious, even though the sound of it is something quite atrocious. If you say it loud enough, you'll always sound precocious. Supercalifragilisticexpialidocious.
They're the songs that provided the soundtrack for our childhood. Upbeat, life-affirming songs about a spoonful of sugar helping the medicine go down, about taking a step in the right direction, keeping your chin up, and always remembering that from the ashes of disaster grow the roses of success. Robert Sherman and his surviving younger brother Richard were the most prolific songwriters in the history of the movie musical. Whilst working at the Disney studio alone, they wrote 150 songs for 27 films.
Gingerbread men have a gingerbread sound.
That's when I first met Bob and Dick 30 years ago. Their collaborative relationship was immediately self-evident. Dick energetically drove the conversation, but Bob, clearly more reserved and quietly spoken, repeatedly completed his brother's sentences and corrected the anecdotes. Only years later, when I got to know them better, did I start to glimpse the extent to which their personalities diverged. While Dick was the ebullient, exuberant showman, Bob, with his private passions for painting, sculpting, poetry, and a questing spiritual nature, was the more thoughtful, contemplative character.
See the birds, toppings a bag,
Poppins. Bob used to say that after the war, he was working on what he hoped would be the great American novel, while Dick, 2.5 years his junior, was trying to write the great American symphony. Disney, who had a sharp eye and a keen ear for talent, intuitively signed the brothers, or as he dubbed them, the boys, to be the studio's resident songwriters.
Now I'm the king of the swingers, oh, the jungle VIP. I've reached the top and had to stop, and that's what's bothering me.
They were soon writing for a slew of live-action and animated family movies. The Parent Trap, The Sword in the Stone, Winnie the Pooh and the Honey Tree and its sequels, and The Jungle Book.
Oh, ooby-doo, I want to be like you.
But it was their work for Mary Poppins in 1964 that showcased their melodic and lyrical dexterity to perfection.
Pour a spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down, the medicine go down, medicine.
Disney handed Bob and Dick a copy of P.L. Travers' novel and asked them to come up with some ideas. Bob, who had recuperated in Britain from his wartime injury, had a great affection for British culture and literature, and it was he who proposed relocating Travers's nanny in Edwardian London.
Let's go fly a kite up.
The brothers created an Oscar-winning score of staggering brilliance.
Go fly a kite and send it soaring.
Over a dozen songs, half of which became and have remained standards.
Chimney, chim, chimney, chim, chim, chirry. Those are three words that don't make sense to me.
Later movies included The Aristocats, Bedknobs and Broomsticks, Charlotte's Web, Snoopy Come Home, and their other enduring triumph, Chitty Chitty Bang Bang.
Oh, you pretty chitty bang bang, chitty chitty bang bang, we love you. Chitty chitty bang bang, chitty chitty bang bang, what you do?
Despite their fame and success, the relationship was, like their heroes Gilbert and Sullivan, often far from harmonious. Bob eventually moved to his beloved London, Dick remaining in Los Angeles. But regardless of whatever physical and emotional distance lay between them, they're forever joined as the authors of a songbook filled with touching, funny, romantic, optimistic, sing-alongable numbers that will live on for generations. And for those who knew Bob apart from that shared heritage, there are fond memories of a talented but modest man who left the world an undeniably happier place.
Well, they won a National Medal of the Arts from George Bush in 2008, despite the fact they were also responsible for two of the biggest travesties in the arts. The first is Dick Van Dyke's Cockney accent in Mary Poppins.
Chim, chimney, chim, chimney, chim, chim, cheree. A sweep is as lucky can be. Chim, chimney, chim, chimney, chim, chim, cheroo. Good luck will rub off when I shake hands with you. Or blow me a kiss. And that's lucky too.
Yeesh, if that wasn't bad enough, they also wrote the most annoying song in the history of the world, played on loop over and over at Disneyland.
It's a small world after all. It's a small world.
And they still gave him the Medal of the Arts. Well, I think we're going to end on that note. I'd like to thank my producer, Sid Tepps. And we're going to close with a song by Richard and Robert Sherman. It was a number one twice in 1960 for Johnny Burnett, who also had a famous brother, Dorsey. But I chose the 1974 version by some fellow named Ringo Starr. This is You're 16.
You're all ribbons and pills. Ooh, what a girl. Eyes that sparkle and shine. You're 16. You're beautiful. And you're mine.